start. In the, so far we discussed the voltage source inverter, okay. Power is coming from the solar side to the DC link, and that power I can connect it to the grid, sorry, that power I can feed it to the grid. If there is a spare capacity, this inverter can supply Q to the grid as well, okay. It can supply both P as well as Q. Now, how to determine P? Now, let us see, instead of doing the inverter theory, I will briefly derive the expression for power, okay. The vector representation of instantaneous three phase quantities, what we, again the definition of space vector itself, three current vectors I can generate as a one vector what is known as a space vector, okay. These are the in phase component and this is the quadrature component, okay. Similarly, therefore, I alpha, I beta, and this is I 0, do not worry why exactly y 0, that is because if I know, see I can get I alpha, I beta or the d axis and q axis components, see alpha, d axis and q axis component or x axis and y axis components, I can get from IA, IB, IC, okay. See here, if I know IA, IB, IC, I can get I alpha, I beta. Now, if I know I alpha, I beta, how can I get IA, IB, IC? Looks like this is a non-singular matrix. Okay. So, what do I need to do? I need to add a third row, need to have a square matrix. So, that is the reason we have added this third row. Do not get into finer details. So if I know IA, IB, IC, I can get I alpha, I beta. Similarly, voltages, if I know VA, VB, VC, I can get E alpha and E beta or EX and EY or ED or EQ. So, these are the D and Q axis components of current, these are D and Q components of voltage, okay. What is the expression for power in terms of, what is the expression for power in terms of this D and Q components? So, we know that expression for instantaneous power is given by VA IA plus VB IB plus VC IC, okay. So, I will substitute for VA IA, VB IB, VC IC in terms of alpha beta components, okay. And these alpha beta components I can get from these the previous two matrices, okay. And I will simplify expression for power, instantaneous power is given by 3 by 2 into E alpha I alpha plus E beta I beta, okay. X axis component of voltage, x axis component of current, y axis component of voltage, y axis component of current. So, in vector form, this is nothing but the dot product itself, E alpha, alpha plus E beta, I beta, okay. Similarly, I can derive the expression for Q, the reactive power, okay. The reactive power, that I can, what is reactive power? See, Vs is the space vector, voltage space vector, Is is the current space vector, okay. The expression for power is Vs, Is, cos of the angle between Vs and Is, okay. And reactive power is Vs, Is into sin of the angle between Vs and Is, that is the expression for power and reactive power. And gone simplifying, I can get a very simple expression, Vs, Is into cos phi, that is what it is. And similarly, reactive power, Vs, Is into sin phi in terms of alpha beta components is E alpha, I beta minus E beta, I alpha. This is the expression for Q. This is the expression for Q. Where E alpha is the D axis component of the voltage, I beta is the Y axis component of the current, E beta is the Y axis component of the voltage, I alpha is the X axis component of the current. So, it is possible to determine the Q supplied by the inverter using these expressions, okay, using this expression, and P using this expression, Vs, Is into cos phi. little bit of simple theory, please. Now, change of reference frame. Why are we doing this? There are few very good advantages. I will tell you the advantage. See, I have had 3-phase voltages here. I had 3-phase voltages, 50 hertz. What did we do? We converted them into alpha beta components, x axis and y axis component. If the frequency of IA, IB, IC is 50 hertz, the frequency of I alpha and I beta is also 50 hertz. See, we just converted IA, half of IB, half of IC, root 3 by 2 IB, root 3 by 2 and IC. So, I am just multiplying by a constant term. So, there is no change in the frequency. Frequency will remain the same. So, frequency of IA, IB, IC, if it is 50 hertz, I alpha, I beta also 50 hertz. If their frequency change in a very narrow band, that is what happens in the grid, I alpha, I beta frequency also will change accordingly. Okay. Now, what I will do is I will transform. So, what did I do? 3-phase stationary frame. Okay. With respect to some stationary member, it is 50 hertz. What I will do is I will transfer this 3-phase to 2-phase alpha beta, and from this 2-phase alpha beta frame to what is known as a frame which is rotating at the synchronous speed. Okay. This is rotating at synchronous speed. At that time, what happens? This 50 hertz frame, it will appear as if it is stationary. Okay. So, I had 50 hertz current, 3-phase current, I converted into 2-phase 50 hertz current. Okay. And if I transform them to a rotating frame which is rotating at omega s, I get DC currents. Why am I doing this? I will tell you. Now, first let us worry about how to convert this 2-phase current which are referred to the stationary frame to a frame which is rotating at omega s. See here, ds and qs are stationary, or this I can call as x and y or alpha beta. Ds and ds qs are stationary. Okay. Whereas, dr and qr, they are rotating at omega s, at the synchronous speed, continuously changing. In other words, theta s is changing with respect to time. So, to this reference frame, stationary reference frame, frequency of current is 50 hertz. Since this frame itself is rotating at synchronous speed, the currents will appear as if they are DC, direct current, DC currents. How do I transform? It is very simple. I will resolve these two components along DS and QS. Okay. Now, see here, what is DR component? The DR component is DS into cos theta S. Similarly, QS into sin theta S, the D axis, DR component. What is the QR component? The quadrature axis. I have to resolve this DR, this DS and QS vector along DR and QR. If it is confusing, what you do is you resolve DR and QR along DS and QS and invert it. That is all. Simple. So, you will get this matrix cos theta s sin theta s minus sin theta s into cos theta s. So, if I know ds and qs, I can convert into dr and qr if I know theta s. If I know how to get this theta s, we will find out. That is the crux of the problem. So, I will repeat, if I know, I can. DS and QS are known. When I know IA, IB, IC, I can get DS and QS, or I can get alpha S and beta S. Nothing, is just a constant multiplication, 1 minus of root 3 by 2 and minus root 3 by 2. I can get DS and QS. Now, if I know theta s, assume that we know theta s, I can get dr and qr. Okay. The dr and qr is nothing but a frame which is rotating at synchronous speed, okay, or synchronous rotating reference frame. Synchronous rotating reference frame, these currents will become DC. Yeah. Now, all this time we found that or discussed that inverter can supply active power, it can supply reactive power. Assume that inverter has to supply active power to the grid at unity power factor. The kVA rating should be equal to kilowatt. Okay. You have chosen you have a 10 kilo kVA inverter and power that is coming from the solar cell is also approximately 10 kilowatt. So, in other words, your inverter has to operate at unity power factor, or you want to operate the inverter at unity power factor, Vs and Is should be in phase. This Vs and Is should be in phase. Okay. How do I make that angle phi is 0, this phi 0? How do I make this phi 0? I want to feed the power to the grid at unity power factor. Now, please, so many times I said assume, assume. All these assumptions that we made, we will try to find out. In the sense, are they valid assumptions or I am just assuming? I told you that previous case here theta s is known. Assume that theta s is known. So, in other words, at any given instant, dr and qr are known. This theta s is continuously changing. That frame is continuously rotating. So, what I will make is, I will make this Vs vector, I will align it along dr. What we will do is, this Vs vector is aligned along dr. In other words, Vs vector does not have a q axis component, it is has only a dr. For any power factor phi, Is is making an angle, this angle with Vs. I want to feed, or the criteria here is power fed to the grid should be at unity power factor. In other words, this angle should be 0. What do I need to make? I need to make this Q component 0. If I make Q component 0, Vs and Is are in phase. In other words, we are feeding power to the grid at unity power factor. In addition, if there is a spare capacity and if you want to supply Q as well, then I have to have a finite angle between Vs and Is. How to determine this finite angle? We'll see. So, what are the various steps that are required now? Vs and Is. So, I have to transform these space vectors to the synchronously rotating reference frame. Before, I have to convert it to two-phase stationary currents, and these two-phase stationary currents I can get from a three-phase currents just by multiplying by constant terms. So, here is a complete procedure, a complete flow chart. Transform all the variables to the synchronously rotating reference frame. Fundamental components of V and I will become DC. See, when I transform them to the synchronously rotating reference frame, the 50 hertz component, they become DC. If there are higher frequency components, they appear as if, how do they appear? It looks something like this. See, if your harmonic spectrum has a 50 hertz component and a say 11th, 13th, any frequency component, no problem. If the reference frame is rotating at 50 hertz, this component will appear as if it is a DC, and this 11th frequency component and 13 frequency component will appear as if it is a high frequency component on the DC. Okay. This is rotating during 11th. So 50 has become stationary. So 11th may appear as if it is a appears as 500 hertz, 13 may appear as if it is a 600 hertz. So what I will do? I will give this to a small low pass filter. I will give it a small low pass filter and I will get a constant DC. I will get a constant DC. And this DC value corresponds to, this corresponds to this 50 hertz component. This 50 hertz component. Now the question is how to get this value of theta s, or in other words, how do I generate the reference? So this is the question. This grid frequency does change for a very narrow band. Okay, how do I generate this reference waveform? See, even if I use a sinusoidal PWM technique, I have to generate 3 sinusoids whose frequency is same as that of the supply. We are discussing now how to synchronize the inverter to the grid. Okay. Now I said we have to use a pulse width modulation technique. It could be a sinusoidal PWM technique or it could be a space vector PWM technique. Okay. Sinusoidal PWM technique, I need to generate 3 sinusoids. Okay. The output voltage of the inverter is proportional to M into VDC. I'll assume that VDC remains constant, therefore output voltage is proportional to M. Now see the problem, power transfer to the grid is, power transfer to the grid is V1 V2 divided by X into sine delta. V1 is the grid voltage, V2 is the output voltage of the inverter. Okay. V1 frequency does change over a very narrow band. As this frequency changes, this frequency also should change. So in other words, both of them should be in synchronism. Okay. Plus this delta has to be. What is this delta? Delta is the angle between V1 and V2. In other words, if V2 is supplying power, I am assuming that V2 is supplying power, V2 should lead V1 by an angle delta. Angle delta. I can measure this angle only when these two frequencies are same. Frequency of these two sinusoids is the same. Okay. I just can't generate 50 hertz sinusoid because frequency of the grid also changes over a very narrow band. So as this frequency changes, I need to change the frequency as well of B2. And B2 frequency is nothing but the frequency of the modulating wave in a sinusoidal PWM technique, or the frequency of the space vector, frequency of the space vector VS. How do I generate the modulating wave for a sinusoidal PWM technique? There are 2 methods. One is a hardware method and a software method. Hardware method is basically outdated, but those who are good in hardware, they can do. But then there is another software method as well. See here, frequency over a narrow band. How will you do it? PLL through hardware, phase lock loop through hardware. What I will do is, this is a source. What I will do is, I have three sinusoids from the source. Using a zero crossing detector, I will convert this sinusoid voltage of the source to a square wave. Okay. So as if the frequency of the sinusoid is changing, the frequency of the square wave also will change. okay. In addition, I will digitize a sine wave, into n number of parts. N could be anything, either 21, 256 or 512 or 1024 or 2048k, whatever, 2k, 3k, whatever, okay. If it is 10024 parts, in other words, what I am saying is, this entire period is divided into 24 parts. So, the resolution is going to be 10 into 24 parts. I will divide them, sorry, I am on the whiteboard, isn't it? I will divide this entire period into 1024 parts and I will store it in an EEPROM. I will store it in an EEPROM. In this EEPROM, there are 1024 steps of sine wave. Now I have to address that EEPROM. Okay. How do I address? To address, I need to have a counter. Counter requires a clock. How do I generate this clock frequency? So, if I address this 1024 parts, if I address this 1024 parts in one cycle, I can get a sinusoid, whose frequency is same as that of the supply voltage. See, I have digitized a sine wave and stored in an EEPROM, okay. Output of the EEPROM is connected to a DAC, that is okay. This EEPROM has to be addressed, that I will use through a counter. Here I am using a 10 bit counter because it is a 1024 1K EEPROM. If I divide into, if I divide this EEPROM into 256 parts, then I need an 8 bit counter, okay. Counter requires a clock. This I will generate using a PLL. What is a PLL? At any given time, these two waveforms are in synchronism. Frequency of this is the same. What I will do? I will convert this as a sine wave using a step down transformer, convert it to a square wave. I get a square wave here, the phase comparator, a voltage controlled oscillator, and a divide by n counter, At any given time, these two waveforms are in synchronism. I am using PLL as a multiplier. I will divide these parts into 1024, this entire 360 into 1024 parts, okay. That I can do it using a PLL, PLL as a multiplier. So, here at this point I have F1 into 50. Why F1? F1 is the frequency of the supply. That waveform is divided by N. Here I have F itself. So, I can generate a sinusoid, whose frequency is same as that of the supply. And I will use this as a modulating wave, okay. For power transfer, angle between this sinusoid and this sinusoid should be delta, okay. Say for example, angle between these two sinusoids should be 5 degrees. What do I do? At this zero crossing, I need to address a location which is equal to sine 5 degrees. So, I will repeat, angle between these two should be 5 degrees. I know the zero crossing of this. At the zero crossing, I need to address a EEPROM here whose location to a location wherein sine 5 degrees address, and I will go on increasing from there. So, therefore, I have generated a sinusoid which leads the source voltage by an angle 5 degrees, that 5 angles happen to be delta. If delta is around 10 degrees, yes, I need to address at the zero crossing to a value which has in which I have stored sine 10 degrees. So this how I connect, or this how I generate three modulating waves. This modulating wave, the frequency of this modulating wave is the same as that of the supply frequency. Okay. As the frequency changes, the frequency of the sinusoid also changes. And depending upon the delta, who decides delta, I will tell you. Depending upon the delta, I at the zero crossing, I need to address that location in EEPROM. So therefore, as of now, we have found a way to generate the modulating waves for a sinusoidal PWM technique whose frequency is same as that of the supply. If the frequency of the supply changes, modulating waveform also will change. Okay? And depending upon delta, I can generate this sinusoid. So, question to Baramati, the answer to Baramati is, I think as of now, we have managed to generate this source VAB whose frequency is same as that of source voltage V1. How did we achieve? That we achieved by generating a modulating wave whose frequency is determined by the supply frequency. Okay? The frequency of V2 is determined by the frequency of the modulating wave. And we have generated the modulating wave using the zero crossing output of the source voltage. And we have divided this part into 1024 parts using a PLL, phase lock loop. At any given time, the frequency of those both the signals is the same. So we have generated three phase sinusoids whose frequency is same as that of the modulating wave, and if I know delta, that I can incorporate here. So that should answer the question which is being asked repeatedly as to how to connect this inverter to the grid. Software approach, what is known as a harmonic oscillator. I'll do this harmonic oscillator, very simple. I do not know whether I'll be able to use. So this is the hardware method of generating. Using a software method, will I be able to do it today? I do not know, but the philosophy is the same. Harmonic oscillator is the x dot is equal to omega into y, and y dot is equal to minus omega into x, where omega is the instantaneous frequency of the harmonic oscillator. Under this condition, what is x and y? X is sin omega t and y is cos omega t. X dot is equal to y and y dot is equal to minus omega x. Now I have two differential equations, I will solve them. What is this? So if x is equal to sin omega t, what is x dot? X dot is equal to omega into cos omega t. Cos omega t is happened to be y. So here is that x dot is equal to omega into y. Y is cos omega t. See, what is y dot? Y dot is equal to omega into minus sin omega t, but sin omega t happened to be x of t. So therefore, y dot is equal to minus omega into x. So here is an implementation. Y dot, integrate it, I will get y. Y into omega is x dot. X dot integrate, you will get x of t. Okay, this is nothing but x dot n plus 1 when omega t. So now comes the control loop. How to determine what, how much P to supply and how much Q to supply? I'll go back to this block diagram. The power is coming from the solar side, from the solar panel. MPPT is the only one knows the power. It draws the maximum power, dumps it to the DC link, and the inverter has to supply the power to the grid. In other words, inverter controller, I will repeat, it is the inverter controller has to choose the suitable value of delta, I am assuming that both modulation index also I am keeping constant, okay, and VDC also has to be regulated. Okay. If V1 and V2 remain constant, power output depends on, power output is just proportional to sin delta, where delta is angle between V1 and V2. Okay. So, if I know delta, see if I know delta, I can generate the modulating wave whose frequency is same as that of the supply, and the phase angle difference between V1 and V2 is delta. See, if I know delta, I can generate, I can incorporate this delta in my control circuit, and that control circuit will generate a sinusoid which is phase displaced by that angle with respect to the supply. Okay. Now, but the question is now how to determine delta. Who will tell me, or how the controller will tell, controller will know to choose the exact value of delta. Now, fine, assume that controller does not know to choose the appropriate value of delta. What will happen? Either delta could be higher than the required, or it could be less than the required. Okay. If it is higher than the required, inverter is trying to supply more power than what it is coming from the solar panel. I'll repeat, the controller has chosen a wrong value of delta, and that delta happens to be higher than the required. Okay. So, under that condition, inverter is trying to supply more power than what it is coming from, or the power is coming from the DC, from the solar side. Under that condition, what happens? There is, we have a one more storage stage, that capacitor. It is trying to supply power, because at any given time there should be a power balance. Okay. If the output power is higher than the input power, in other words, inverter is trying to supply more power than what it is, what the power coming from the DC side. Capacitor starts supplying power. Under that condition, capacitor voltage starts falling. Instead, if the power supplied is less than the power output from the solar, the remaining power has to go through the capacitor. If the power supplied by the inverter is less than power output from the solar panel, the difference in these two powers has to go to the capacitor. Under that condition, capacitor voltage starts increasing. If there is a perfect balance between input and output, capacitor voltage will remain constant. So, what I will do is, I am not bothered about what is the output of the maximum power tracker. I will try to regulate the DC link voltage, that's all. If I'm able to do that, I have achieved the perfect power balance. In other words, the inverter is supplying whatever the power that is coming from the DC, from the solar panel to the grid. Of course, I'm neglecting the losses. Or if I take the losses into account, power transfer to the grid is power coming from the solar minus the losses that are taking place. So, if I am able to regulate the DC link voltage, I have achieved the perfect power balance, and I have achieved, or the controller has chosen the right value of delta. So, if I know the right value of delta using the hardware PLL, we are able to generate a modulating wave which is displaced by an angle delta, okay, and whose frequency is same as that of the supply. As the degree frequency changes, supply frequency also will change. So, as of now, the two burning questions in the sense repeatedly being asked, how do I synchronize? Yes, using a hardware PLL, we are able to do it. How to use a software PLL, we will see. I will not be able to cover today, maybe tomorrow. How to supply P? That I have answered. Now, assuming that there is a spare capacity and inverter can supply Q, how to do that? or at night, there is no insulation at all. Okay, there is no active power input from the solar. How do I do that? I will take the second case first, and then we'll discuss both P and Q together. At night, there is no active power input. Okay, there is no power, active power input. We know that inverter can supply any Q as long as it is less than the required. Okay, to do that, this inverter has to draw some power from the grid. Now the source is supplying a delta P, a small amount, to the inverter. Now the modulating wave has to lag the source voltage by an angle delta, because the direction of power flow has changed. In other words, now V1 is here, V2, and this delta is very small, to just to account for losses. Okay, what is the Q to be supplied by the inverter? Who will tell what should be the Q? There are two ways. Okay, one is if it is just supplying Q to the load, I will assume that there is a separate controller which will tells, which informs this controller of the inverter to supply the required amount. Or if it has to supply Q to the grid, okay, how to determine the exact value, how to determine that value of that Q? By the way, how to determine the required value of Q to the grid, how to determine the Q required by the grid? How do I determine? In the previous case, we regulated the DC link voltage. If I am able to regulate the DC link voltage, I have achieved perfect balance and I am transferring the required power to the grid. Now, how to supply the required power, required Q to the grid? What I will do is, now I will take the grid voltage or the voltage at the coupling point. Okay, I will take the voltage at the coupling point. Okay, this, and take it as a reference. This is the grid voltage as the reference. This is the actual grid voltage plus minus delta. Sorry, this is the error. I will give it to a PI regulator. What is the output of the PI regulator? What it will be? It is the Q required. Output of the PI regulator is going to be the Q regulator. Why? That is because at steady state, error is 0. At steady state, error is 0 of the PI regulator, because I am using a PI regulator. If error is 0, it implies that the actual grid voltage is, actual grid voltage is equal to the reference. But if there is an error, there is a mismatch between the required value and the actual value. If this grid voltage is higher than the reference value, Q supplied by the inverter is more than the required. Okay? If the grid voltage is less than the required, the Q supplied by the inverter is less than is required. Okay, as a, here I am making an assumption that inverter has the capacity to supply the entire Q. That's all. So using this loop, I'll take grid voltage as the reference. Sorry, the required grid voltage to be maintained at a particular value. This is the reference voltage. Error, PI regulator. This will give Q required by the grid. In the previous case, I will keep the DC link some reference, actual DC link plus minus error, a PI regulator and delta. This is a DC link voltage that has to be maintained at a particular reference value, actual DC link that is measured, error is processed by a PR regulator, output of the PR regulator will determine delta. Why? Why it is delta? That is because at steady state this error has to be 0, and that can happen only when there is a perfect power balance. Perfect power balance. In other words, error is 0 implies actual DC link voltage is equal to the reference. So, the inverter is supplying the correct amount of power to the grid. Whatever that is coming from the solar, it is transferring to the grid. Yeah. So, I will stop here. I will take a few questions. The software PLL, I will discuss it in my next lecture, that is tomorrow. And from tomorrow onwards, I will also start the modification that we need to make in already discussed DC to DC converters and the inverters. Okay. Any questions? Bharamati, is it clear how to synchronize the inverter to the grid? If it is not clear now, I will explain to you again. Feel free. There are so many questions being asked, how to synchronize, yesterday there was a question from COEP, how the inverter can supply both P and Q. I have answered, if it is not clear, I will explain to you again. Yeah, Bharamati back. Yeah.
Sir, question is once again, space vector PWM. Sir, in case of that space vector PWM, if we open all switches for the required dead time, will it do?
In the sense, I do not know. You can either apply 0, 0, 0 or 1, 1, 1 for 0 voltage vector. But another condition is at any given time only one switch should be turned on or off. By the way, this is a very basic space vector PWM technique. There are a lot of modifications that have been done. I am discussing the very basic PWM technique. It says at any given time only one switch should be turned on or off. Now at T is equal to 0, you have to start. So you have to start from the origin, all of them are off. Then I have to apply 0, 0, 1. Then 1, 1, 0, 1, 1 and come back. So you may not be able to start directly from 1, 1, 1 and come here. So it all depends on your previous state. You can either make it all 0 or make it all 1, provided you need to know the previous state. If the previous state is 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, then you can do 1, 1, 1. Previously, see, at any given time you are at the origin, it could be either 0, 0, 0 or 1, 1, 1. Now, if you are 0, 0, 0, don't you think you have to start from here, go there and come back?
So, opening all the switches will not do?
No, 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 I will not say that. How can I possibly say that opening all this will not do? What is your initial state? Have you turned off all the devices, or have you turned off all the upper devices, or have you turned on all the upper devices? Now that you need to know. What is your control algorithm? Assuming that all of them are off, you have 0, 0, 0. Next logical step is 0, 0, 1. If all of them are 1, then I think you have to go for 0, 1, 1 and come back. I told you T1 can be applied anytime, T2 can be applied anytime, but then total sum of, and they can be divided as well. So if you have disabled the inverter, or if in the initial state is 1, 1, 1, all of them you have turned on, you have to come from 0, 1, 1 and 0, 0, 1. It is not only the whether to apply 0, 0, 0 or 1, 1, 1, you need to know the conducting state of the previous, you need to know the previous state as well. Is that answers your question? What exactly is exactly your doubt? Why are you, what is your main doubt?
Sir, in case of implementing,
Implementing the dead band. Dead band has nothing to do with the PWM technique. It is a that you require because the voltage source inverter. Dead band, if it is IGBT, you provide around 3 to 4 microseconds. That you provide. You provide 3 to 4 microseconds of dead time. Don't bother about whether you are in 000 or 111. You have a dead band of 3 to 4 microseconds. You want to make it, you want to completely eliminate dead band? I won't suggest that to do. Please, don't do that.
No, I won't be eliminating. I want to implement dead band. So that's why I'm asking whether it is possible.
How are you implementing the dead time in a hardware? How are you implementing this dead time? Through hardware?
Software, DSP, processor.
I see. Then yes, you may have to add up. Why, in the sense, is there a control? Why are you increasing the software overheads? See the complexity that is involved. Why can't you? Of course, I am not saying that it is not possible to incorporate this 3 microsecond. Whether the DSP has the time to do all this? You have to incorporate 3 microseconds. Whether the DSP has time or not, I don't want to get into those issues. Either through hardware or software, you have to. And it, I don't think it is depend on 000 or 111. It is a switching instant of switches belong to one leg. And I am not able to understand exact point. You send me an email, I will try to answer that. Now, one second, how to choose the gain? No. How to choose the gain of the controller? You have to do the system modeling, simulate, and you have to choose the gain. The question is how to choose the gains of the PI controller? You have to do the system modeling, then you have to get the transfer function. Now you have to choose, you can choose the values of gain once you have the transfer function. Yes, by doing the stability studies, you can choose. For that, you need to do the modeling and simulation. Apply low pass filter to eliminate harmonics for high power rating is will affect our efficiency or not? ABBC, what is the question? I am not able to understand. What efficiency are you talking about?
Yes, sir. Sir, in previous section, we are seeing about the to eliminate the harmonics, we are applying a low pass filter, it will eliminate some of the harmonics for 500 Hz and 600 Hz frequency. So, but in a solar panel, we are getting only low power. So, for that low power device, if we are applying a filter, so it will take its own reactive losses. So, then how can we manage this, sir?
No, please, which low pass filter you are talking about? No, you misunderstood. I told you, the question to you is how to get this synchronously rotating reference frame. Once you get the reference, synchronously rotating reference frame, I told you all the components or the fundamental component will become DC, rest will appear as high frequency AC. Okay. If I want to see, I have to generate a modulating wave or whatever reference wave which is a sinusoid. Okay. I need to generate pure sinusoids. How do I generate 3 pure sinusoids? If your waveform has harmonics, how do I generate? How do I generate a pure sinusoid? if your waveform has harmonics, how do I generate your sinusoid? Assume that grid.
So it's not possible if it contains harmonics.
If it has harmonics, fundamental component will appear as DC. All the harmonic components will appear as high frequency. Now this DC component corresponds to the fundamental frequency. I want only the fundamental component. I want to know only the fundamental component. How do? I have to put a low pass filter in the control circuit, not in the power circuit. In the control circuit, I have to put a low pass filter. Efficiencies, what efficiency? In the sense, losses of this resistor. This may be, this I am doing in a control circuit, not in power circuit.
Sir, one more question. Yeah.
Sir, in a DC to DC converter, the voltage gets boosted up and the current gets dropped. There is a decrease in current. So, how do we deal that current when we are connecting it to an inverter, sir?
Ma'am, it is a power balance. Power balance. Don't confuse about voltage current. There is a solar panel. You are boosted. There is some voltage, but there is some current coming. So energy is being stored in the capacitor, right? It has to go to the inverter and have to feed it to the grid. It is the power that should be balanced. P in should be equal to P out, assuming losses or neglect in the losses. How do I achieve? If I am controlling this voltage, see some reference, say 800 volts I want to keep. This is, so 800 volts is the reference, okay, and this is the actual DC link voltage. Actually, I will measure this, okay, this is the actual plus minus error PI. This is delta. At steady state, error is 0. So, at steady state, if error is, that can happen only when V actual is regulated at 800. So, under that condition, whatever the, so capacitor is not supplying any power. So, whatever the power that is coming is going out. So, I have achieved the power balance. Okay. I am not saying that converter is, if, so power balance is P out is nothing but V1, V2 divided by X into sine delta. I have chosen the right value of delta. If there is a mismatch of something, you, that will reflect in the actual DC link voltage. If there is a mismatch of power, DC link voltage has to change. If it is not changing, there is a power balance. Now, why worry when the voltage is high, currents are low, when the currents are low, when the currents is high, voltage is low. You talk about power. Is that okay? What are the parameters to be considered while selection of inductor in the bidirectional converter? One parameter is the harmonic current generated by the inverter. If the grid voltage is assumed to be sinusoidal, we cannot generate an ideal sine wave from the inverter. We cannot generate. The inverter has its, so the output voltage waveform of the inverter has its own harmonic spectrum, okay, that is given by the switching frequency. This is fundamental, and depending upon the PWM strategy, you will have a predominant harmonic. What is the, this is the equivalent circuit for the fundamental frequency. Now I have to find out what is the current supplied to the grid by this harmonic. What is the harmonic equivalent circuit? It is, there is no harmonic voltage in the grid, so it is 0. So this is the magnitude of the harmonic. This is the impedance of offered by this inductor for this harmonic. So In is equal to Vn divided by n into omega L, omega 1 into x, sorry, into L. So finally, you know what should be the THD that is given by the standard. So one of the ways is to determine, so that will determine your value of L. If your switching frequency is low, depending upon the PWM strategies, its magnitude is determined, magnitude gets fixed, it is approximately DC link voltage itself. It depends on your PWM strategy. This depending upon the PWM strategy, you will know the frequency of the predominant harmonic. Okay? So therefore, you know N as well as Vn. The standards will tell you what should be the total THD. So once I know THD, the various harmonic components also will be determined, and therefore L. That is one of the ways. Other way, when you do the current control, there are other methods also, other parameters as also will determine the value of, will affect the value of L. That I will discuss later. Maybe I think time is running out.